desde atrás y ajustando mi presentación basado en lo que...
Lo mío es más práctico basado en la teoría tuya.
Geometrical optics 2, paraxial theory, microscope imaging and color illumination, objectives and eyepieces by Dr. Humberto Cabrera Morales from the Venezuelan Institute of Scientific Research and the ICT.
Thank you. Good morning again. Okay, in previous lectures we learned about lens image formation and other topics related with that. What we will do today is to use this theory and to apply it to the microscope. And we will see how lens work inside the microscope, because in the microscope we have lens, we have lens for creating the image, but also we have a set of lens for the illumination of the sample. And the same principles apply. As I said you before, I have here some objective. This is Nikon. This, for example, is around the maximum set of lens, around 17 lengths here. But as I say you before, is the image formation is based on the lens maker equation and what we studied before. And then we will see that, but we will start with simple lens, with single lens in each case as a simplification. And finally, we will explain about the objective, how it's going on with this, okay? Let's remember and start again with the lens maker equation and image formation. You know that using the lens maker equation, taking into account the distance, how far away is placed the object from the lens, we will have the image. And taking into account the focal length of the lens, we can calculate where to put the detector. But also, we can build it using the three laws that we studied yesterday. As we know, a parallel beam of light coming through the lens, we have an object, in this case, place a leader before, a little after the focal length of the lens. In this case, a parallel beam of light, we know that this object, for example, is a light source, a point source can be, is emanating a lot of rays, and these rays are collected by this lens. This parallel beam of light pass through the focal length of the lens. We can build the image, as I said before, using two of these rays. The ray passing through the center will be directly, and we have the tip of the image here. We can use another ray coming from the focus also, but he will be, in this case, coming again to create the image, as we know, and we studied yesterday. as we can see in this image, in different colors, the three rays representing the three laws. Let's now we start to apply this for a microscope objective that I say you now is represented here by a single lens. This is the objective that we know can be a set of lengths. If you have a microscope from 90s, 70s, or even 80s, they are called finite objective lengths. They are working based on this principle. What that is mean? It means that for this kind of a microscope, or this kind of microscope, were designed in a way that the object is placed a little after the focal length of the lens. Very, very, at very short distance. This is what we had in the previous image, similar to this. Okay? Then we will have a projection here of the image of this object. In this case, if we use the lens maker equation, we know that this object or this image, this is called intermediate image plane. We will have at the final of this lecture, we will see and we will study about the image plane in the microscope. The image will be created here in this place. Normally, in this kind of microscope, or in this design, because it's a design, this distance is around 150 millimeters, okay? And after that, we have the eyepiece, which is another lens, that take this image and create a parallel beam of light together with the lens of our eyes, create the same image in your retina, okay? In some case, you don't need to use this. If you have a CCD camera and you want to see, you put there directly the sensor, as we will see after this slide, and you will have there an image. We will see in the lab that in some case, we don't have enough magnification to see this image, even with a CCD camera. And we need a second lens, but doesn't matter. It depends on the magnification do you want. Because each lens, as we will see in the next slide, give an additional, or the relation between the focal length of the lens produce, or it's so called or is related with the magnification of the system. For more recently microscope, if you have microscope from the 90s, even now, they work based on a different design. In this kind of microscope, the image or the object is exactly at the focal length of the objective lens. As you know, when you have the object here, after the lens you have a parallel beam of light. This parallel beam of light gives you no image formation there. You need a second lens that in this case is called tube lens. Why this? This gives you a flexibility in the design of the microscope. For example, you can add there additional components, lens, filters, and so on. And also, this additional lens gives you an additional magnification. As I said you before, the magnification of the system is related with, it's a ratio between the focal length of this lens that normally, usually, is larger than the focal length of the objective, then we have an additional magnification there. These are the main reasons why this new design was taken into account. And in any case, I will be referring to both designs. To remember you, that point, okay? What happened after the objective take this image? As I say you before, I will add both systems. And what happened, how we can detect this image? Oh, we can detect, of course, directly in our eyes. If we have the first system, we have intermediate image here, the eyepiece, parallel beam of light, then focus onto the retina. If we use the second system, that I say you has less magnification because this lens gives an additional magnification, we have also parallel beam of light and also the image there. Then, we can have also, nowadays, for example, a CCD camera. Where to add, where to locate the CCD camera? We have different options. If we have a system with a tube lens, as here, we can add the CCD camera after the tube lens here, because the tube lens take the parallel beam of light here and create the image. As I said you before, if you need an additional magnification, you can add a second lens. We will play with this in the lab with different lens for image formation and also for color illumination. And you will see that this is only applying the concepts that we studied here. It's very easy. Okay? And this is another kind of a system, for example, using laser. This is a fluorescent microscopy, for example. You insert the sample here, you get the fluorescent there, and you can add the camera here. Of course, this is what I say you before, that this system allow you to add additional elements there, filters, mirrors, and so on. Normally, or nowadays, many microscopes has the possibility to add or to incorporate lasers. They have place for mirror and for filters and so on due to this new configuration of infinite image, okay? But also you can add a CCD camera after the eyepiece, and you have an additional magnification there because you will have the magnification of the tube lens and the eyepiece. And you can, normally you know that some microscope has the CCD camera here or normal camera, okay? But we were here in this review, okay? The objective, and we study how this image is created in our eyes or in a CCD camera. But we need also to illuminate the sample to see the details of the specimen there. And for that, we have this system here in which we also use lens. Normally, we have a lamp. We can use different kind of lamp depending on the application, or laser. We'll have in the lab both possibilities. We'll use even LED and laser, both. Normally, we have a collector lens, which of course collect the light coming from the light source and focus the image of this light source in the back the front focal plane of the condenser lens. We will see also in the lab, and we will check how to create this image in the correct plane, taking into account the focal lens of the collector lens, the location of the diaphragm, of the condenser diaphragm, and also in some microscopes, not in all, you have a collector lens, a field lens. Both together, the function is to take the image of the lamp and to create this image in the front focal point of the condenser. We have there. You can create it when you know, applying the lens maker equation. Normally, for the objective, also we have back focal plane. Normally, it's the region where you have a ring there, but you calculate it using the lens maker equation. In the lab, we will see that if you know the focal lens of the collector lens, you know where this image will be. Then, if you have a condenser lens, of course, you know the focal length of this lens, you add there this image at the focal distance of the collector lens, of the condenser lens. Because, as I will explain now, you need for color illumination, or for an even illumination, uniform illumination to the sample, you need a color illumination. It means parallel beam of light. You add your front focal point exactly at the focal length of this lens. Then you have a parallel beam of light. You create it. We will see in the lab. Yes, we measure the focal distance and so on, and normally companies do it. When you have this objective, the back focal plane is there, where you have in the back plate, you have a ring. Intentionally, they did there, and you know that the back focal plane is there. Due to that, in the lab, we will have a objective and also lens, because for clear understanding and for working and looking at these planes, we need lens, because normally in the microscope objective is inside this plane, and you cannot see there. But in the lab, we have similar, we have an open microscope with larger distance, large focal length, you to be able to play there, to measure, but you can calculate it, okay? I explain here what company can do, but also what we can do. We can build a microscope. We have there in the lab, okay? Then, normally, we have, in some microscope, you don't have field. In the lab, we will have only collector lens, condenser lens, condenser diaphragm, only that. But we can add, if we have good image, we don't need a field lens. Of course, if you have a field lens, also there is a field diaphragm, okay, here. Normally, this diaphragm or iris are located in the four planes, image plane and source planes of the microscope. And you can see simultaneously all this plane. I will explain this later, okay? Wait, the condenser, as I say, you create a parallel beam of light. Nowadays, we use color illumination, not critical illumination. In critical illumination, we focus the image of the light source in the specimen. It means that we will have also in the CCD camera or in the eyes, we will have the image of the specimen, but also the image of the light source. This is not good. This is why nowadays we use color illumination. And we will play with this in the lab. All these concepts. Okay? now, as I say you, we need color illumination. For color illumination, I will explain here in this. Each time I add both configuration and for better understanding, okay? We have here, this technique is recommended by all manufacturers of modern laboratory microscopy because it can produce specimen illumination that is uniformly bright and free from glare, allowing the user to realize the microscope full potential, okay? In color illumination, as I say you, the image of the source will be in the back, in the front focal plane of the condenser, and onto the sample we have parallel beam of light. This parallel beam of light will be collected by the objective, and we will have again, this plane is conjugate with this plane, and is conjugate with this plane. Normally, in the eyepiece, you can see all this plane there. You see this iris, you see the image and the iris. You open down the iris, you have less or more illumination, but you see the iris there. And when you add, and you can see very clear this iris, it means you are in the correct, or your iris is in the correct place, is in the back focal, front focal plane of the condenser. Then, this all plane are the field planes. They are simultaneous. You can see this plane simultaneously, okay? When we have color illumination and for checking the color illumination, we will see in the lab this plane here, this is the back focal plane of the objective. We will place, for example, here, a diffraction grating. What we will have here in the back focal plane of the objective, we will have the diffraction pattern of this grating. And we will play there in the lab with this diffraction pattern, and we will remove some details of the image, okay? And how we can see this diffraction pattern? In the case of the grating, in the case of this, we will see, of course, there. And with a second lens, we take this image, and we will see in other plane this image very very clear. But also, we have another lens, or moving the lens, we will have the location of this plane, and with the focal length of the lens, we can separate this plane. Normally, in microscopy, you cannot see these planes, but there is an additional lens that is called Beltran lens. You add this lens there, and instead of the image plane, you can see the field planes, okay? But how to check about color illumination? When you have the sample, if you want to check that you have perfect, in this case with LED, color illumination, normally when you have color illumination, you have parallel beam of light. How to check and to see the image of the light source and to check that you have perfect color illumination? You use a second lens, and you know that when you have a parallel beam of light, this lens can be located in any place. But at the focal length of this lens, you will have the image of the light source. If your lens, as we will see in the lab, is 10 centimeters, and as in our case, at 10 centimeters, you will have a perfect image of the LED source. If not, you don't have perfect color illumination because you don't have parallel beam of light. You will have maybe the image after, for sure, at 11 or 12 centimeters. This is the way to check about color illumination and what we will do in the lab. Okay? Here in this diagram, I show you the conjugate field planes, as we were explained here, and aperture planes here, in this case, as I say you. This is the image of the sample here. This is the intermediate plane. Also, the field diaphragm. This is what you can see through the eyepiece of the microscope. Together with the image, you will see all these iris. And playing with this iris, for example, with the condensed diaphragm, you change the illumination of the sample. If you play with the field stock diaphragm, you change the field of view. Also, this is the importance of diaphragms. And due to that, they are located in this plane, because allow you also to play with the illumination, with the field of view, that are also very important parameters in microscopy. Okay? Now, we speak about critical illumination. So I say you, in critical illumination, the image of the lamp, the filament in this case, will be created here together, will be together, as we can see here, with the sample. And this is not good, because you don't have even illumination, and you will see together with the sample the image of the filament. It's very clear why it's not a good this setup. Okay. Now, color illumination versus critical illumination. I review here, but we spoke about this. Light source image planes, you know, I repeat again, lamp filament, condensed diaphragm, back focal plane of the objective, and the eye point. And the specimen image plane, they are represented here also, both. The field diaphragm, the specimen, the intermediate image plane, and the edge retina or camera sensor. Okay? Now we again review about conjugate planes and define as a simultaneously in focus and appear. They appear superimposed, all these planes. Without Beltran lens or with Beltran lens, you can shift in between this set of plane. But this is very, very important concepts in microscopy. But now, and we concentrate on the objective properties. As I say you, the objective, we have here an objective from the 1970s. This is finite Gorkin system. And this is recently, this is the another kind of objective. Okay? Then for the objective, as I say before, we have many class. We have, for example, a chromat that has around 5 lengths. Or we can have more complicated objectives. We have fluorite that are better quality, but of course more expensive. This is around 17 lengths, a combination of lengths. So you can see there. Of course, it's more expensive, but it's without achromatic aberration, spherical aberration, all corrected there. Of course, this is proportional to the price of the objective. High quality, high price. Okay? They are mainly And all of them are plan version. This is, I say that I will only concentrate in the main or more complicated aberration in the microscope. But we have also coma, we have, but Miguel will explain about this. We have astigmatism also. We have flat field distortion. All of these are corrected for the flat field, okay? But achromats, okay, they are axial, corrected for red and blue, for these two wavelengths, for the chromatic aberrations. But for spherical aberration, for the green light at this wavelength, they are also corrected, okay? Fluorides are, or so-called, it's also semi-apo, axial for 2 to 4 colors, and spherical, 2 to 4 colors also. And the more sophisticated apochromats, they are corrected axial, of course, for 4 to 5 colors. We have for violet, for blue, green, and red. We can use all these wavelengths, and all available in plan versions, okay? I will explain there how to identify these properties when you buy an objective. Now, let's we concentrate on the numerical aperture.
The last one, the
atmospheric. Which? This is the more sophisticated objective. What I showed before, they have around 17 lengths. They are corrected for chromatic aberration, for spherical aberration, even for coma, for far field distortion, for astigmatism, all. Due to that, they are so expensive. Hey, you know, I will explain after that. When you have a chromatic aberration corrections objective, you must select the correct immersion oil. Normally, companies say you, if you buy this objective, you must buy, for example, Nikon, you need also oil from Nikon. If you use another oils, you will introduce, I will explain about this. Independently of this, that you have corrections, you can introduce also distortion if you use another kind of oil, mainly for chromatic aberration, because you are introducing another medium there. I will explain about the chromatic aberration. You know, it's related with the dispersion of the media. And if they sell you this kind, Nikon, for example, of oil, you use this because they match the refractive index of this oil with the objective. If you use another, with another refractive index, you will have chromatic aberration. You will introduce. And for spherical, I will explain also there are different ways to correct this kind of aberration. Okay? Now, this is the most important property of the objective, the numerical aperture. I say you before that also is related with the resolution. And this is one of the most important properties. We will see that the resolution is, you have to separate the resolution with the magnification. You can have a lot of magnification, but the first objective, the objective is the element which define the resolution. And you can magnify this, but with the same resolution. There was a paper, I don't know if Miguel knows about that, was published in 1970s, not remember exactly. They reported even a super resolution technique using a photocopy machine, you know? They add, and was published after some people understood that this is not correct. We will see this in the lab. you add the sample in the photocopy machine, and then you get the image. This image, again, you increase the magnification, and they reported even they were looking at the atoms there. This is not possible, it's wrong, because the magnification is one property that is not related with the resolution, it's different. And for example, in this equation, we have the refractive index of the medium between the sample and the objective. As I said you before, you can use air, water, different medium with different. I will explain why this increase the resolution. And we can have also different numerical aperture depending on this angle. This is a gating angle that the objective can collect. Of course, if you have if this angle is bigger, you have a higher numerical aperture. The image will be bright, okay, as you can see here. Also, the working distance, that is another property of the, normally, this is not the focal length of the objective. The working distance is where you have to add the sample, because, for example, for finite objective, it's in different place. It's not at the place of the focal distance. And it's where you have to place the sample to have the proper image formation. At this distance also depends on the numerical aperture. We have here an example with different angles, gathering angles, and we have different numerical aperture. Okay? Now, in this case, we have another example of the, we are comparing there, different numerical aperture with different angles and different working distance. Of course, the working distance or also depend, if you don't need so high resolution, depend on which sample you will use here, and as we will see in the lab, also allow you to add there a mirror, for example, in thermal lens, we will have there a mirror for the resonator. For that, you have to use long focal distance. Of course, you don't have a very high resolution, but maybe it's enough for your application. It depends. Okay? This is a trade-off. And now, why immersion media? Okay, of course, why immersion media increase the numerical aperture? Okay, because you avoid total internal reflection. What immersion media do is that if you have a glass, the refractive index of the glass is around 1.5, as we saw before. And normally, immersion oil has around 0.5. If you have air here, what happened? The beam coming there will be refracted in this direction. You lose resolution because you are losing there the ray coming at a higher angle from the sample. As we will see in the lab, this contains very valuable information. But if you put here an oil immersion media, you will collect all this ray coming from there, and you will increase, of course, you avoid total internal reflection. This is the point. And you increase the numerical aperture and, of course, the resolution. Okay? This is an example of the, this is around 1.5. This is the maximum value. It's around there. We can obtain using the base oil, of course, without introducing additional distortion, and using blue light, you know? This is another example of a calculation of the numerical aperture and how this angle corresponds with the numerical aperture. We have here some examples of the angle using specific numerical aperture objective the angle we can obtain. This is the maximum angle we can obtain using the maximum numerical aperture objective. Oil immersion, of course. Okay? Now we concentrate in the chromatic and spherical aberration. I will not speak about coma and so on, but also these aberrations are present in the microscope, but these are the more complicated and more common aberration. You know that when we have a dispersion, different colors bend in different way. The blue light is the more bended light there, and the red is less. In the lens, we have the same. The blue light will be projected, the focus of the blue light will be projected here, closer to the lens, and the red light after that. Then you have there a dispersion, which will introduce a mistake, or will distort the image, okay? If you are using white light, okay? But how to correct a chromatic aberration? Normally, we use another dispersive element with different refractive index. It's very clear here that if we have the blue light is focused close to the lens and the red one there, when you introduce this element here with this shape, the blue light will be diverging in this case, and the red light will be coming to the focus, okay? And this is a way, when we use this doublet, we have it inside the design of the objective, and this correct, here is an example of how it works, how the chromatic aberration can be avoided in the objective. Here an example of very well corrected objective for chromatic aberration. But what happened with spherical aberration? Spherical aberrations, as I say you yesterday, when we have spherical surface, they are not perfect focusing elements. And we know that the rays coming, even for monochromatic light, when we have a monochromatic light, the light coming from here will be focused normally here, and the light passing close to the center will be focused far away. And we have also a dispersion here, and of course a distortion of the image. These corrections, this aberration. But before to continue with this, I have to say, I say you before, that for chromatic aberration also you must select the correct oil immersion media. If not, you introduce aberration. For spherical aberration is different. It's not related with the media there. There are other methods for correcting this kind of aberration, correction colors. It's a kind of set, I will explain now, of set of lengths with a ring that you can move there, and you correct this, mainly the peripheral beams to coincide with the central beams. We will see now how we can do that in the microscope. This is the case. Oh, this is correction color for spherical aberration. This is a correction color adjustment ring. How it works? Okay. Normally, for a spherical aberration, what we have is this. Okay, here. We have some part of the light is focused here, and part of the light is focused here. We have a distortion in the image. This is due to that, the fact that the lens and the this ray are spread off more than the central rays. What the correction color do is to move this ray inside, to come parallel, and this that is represented here in red to coincide with the, this ray to correct the spherical aberration. Normally, you move this color and you make this ray to come parallel. This is the way to correct this kind of aberration. Okay? Normally, in the microscope, in the objective, it's right in there. If it has correction color. Okay. Yes, I will explain about this now, but not so much as for a chromatic aberration, okay? Not so much. We can discuss about this. It's related. You are right. It's related because I will. This is what I will explain now. The, for example, there are additional aberration due to the sample, the microscope slide, and so on. You know, you can have a sample in which you have a specimen there, a cell, I don't know. You have water inside. The refractive index of these each elements are different. And for calculation of the these correction colors and for chromatic aberration, you have to take into account, you have to assume a model which refractive index will have your specimen. It depends on this. And if you have a specimen there with water and other components that have different refraction index, you will have a mixture there. And you have to assume some average value. And of course, this influence, but mainly the chromatic aberration. Because the spherical aberration, as the name say, is mainly related with the spherical surface there that are not perfect. Of course, if you have, but in a specimen, some component that also refract the light in different way, you have an additional spherical aberration, okay? But in this way, but we can discuss about this also. Okay. Now, as I say you before, the magnification of the objective is related with the magnification of the system at all. Magnification of the objective, the eyepiece, and you can have intermediate factor there and other elements, I don't know, the tube lengths and so on. And the overall magnification is depend on this all components, but depending on the, on your application, you can amplify more or less. Okay. And now I think today I will have time. I was thinking maybe to start the other lecture, but we will see. We'll see. Still 12:30. I think we will have so much time. I will finish at 12 maybe. Okay. Let's now. We look at the properties of the objective. We can have many questions because this is a very interesting topic and also important. We look, when you buy objective, what is important there, okay? This is the magnification, of course. Plan means it's corrected for the far field distortion. Miguel will explain about this kind of aberration. Apochromat, we saw before, they are corrected for many wavelengths, many colors. This means, of course, the manufacture. As I say you, flat field correction, it's plan. APO, aberration correction. This is the magnification. This is a numerical aperture, of course. This is what I discussed with you before. Dic, mean, or here, is represented. The main application of this objective, what you can do with this, you can do interfering contrast microscope with this. Now, this is the main application of this objective. What does this mean, this infinity here? What does it mean? This is what I say before. It's not finite correction. It's infinite corrected. Okay? You need a tube length for this kind of objective. And you need to add the sample, or in the microscope, they use this objective. Normally, usually, the sample is located at the focal length of this objective. This is the cover glass that you can use with this objective. Normally, cover glass are around 0.17. It's an average value. This means that for this objective, you need to use a cover glass in this range. If not, you will have aberrations. Okay? This is the working distance. This is where you have to put the sample. Here we have a cover glass. Okay, and another, this is related with the magnification. These are the main properties of the objective that you have to look when you need to buy an objective for any kind of application or a specific application. I want to stop here because this lecture was not so. Maybe we can have discussion here. It's mainly related with the aberration. Normally you focus.